are with me on TV Africa Channel 45. I came under Sharif, I was born, and I shall achieve. So, today we are going to look at real democracy. Remember, I started the trend, and that is when I said to you that we shall be looking here in a place where lightning is arrested, or at least where thunder comes to rest. So, I said we shall be looking at democracy, and we shall be looking at some of the countries that claim to be promoting democracy in the rest of the world. You shall get a chance to ask a question by sending it to typing only SMS messages. So you'll be typing TV Africa space question and send it to 8008. TV Africa space question and send it to 8008. My studio is taking shape, and if you see me miss questions and answer, it will be because we are doing more construction. We are setting ourselves up. On the side, you will be seeing some images, and those are images of black people in ancient times. In Spain, in Portugal, in Germany. These will be images of black people like that in the image of black people in Mexico. The Moors of Spain, those are what they looked like. Tall, gregarious, confident. But we shall get to that. That image that you see in the background, it's Maurice the Moor. So, we are going to be examining countries where democracy has been spread. We often ask a question, why aren't we? People say that third world countries are not democratic, or they don't get a chance to be democratic, or they don't build democratic institutions. That is a joke, because where they attempt to build democratic institutions, somebody, some country comes and removes democratically elected government, and removes the democratically elected governments and sets in place a different government. So today we are going to be looking at some of these governments, some of these revolutions that have taken place, and we shall dare ask the question, who removed these governments? And we shall be saying, will the real Democrat please stand up? Will the real Democrat please stand up? So one by one, I'll be rolling clips. I will show you the year, I will show you what happened in that particular country. And I'll tell you who did it. Who did it? Who invaded the country? Who removed the democratically elected leader and installed a leadership that you and I do not find useful? So we shall be looking at that, and we shall be considering that. So let me ask, roll the tape. Let's get the first clip.
Fact, he increased Noriega's salary to more than $100,000 a year and eliminated a requirement that intelligence reports on Panama include information on drug trafficking. With support from the CIA, Noriega was able to outmaneuver his rivals, and in August of 1983, he became commander of the Panamanian military. As the Reagan administration expanded its covert war against the Sandinista government in Nicaragua, Noriega became increasingly helpful. Working with the CIA and with Israeli arms dealers, Noriega helped coordinate an arms supply network to provide weapons to Contra bases in northern Costa Rica.
Noriega's involvement in the drug traffic really increased his importance as a source for the CIA and as someone who was able to conduct dirty tricks in the region for the CIA.
That image that you see is an image of Manuel Noriega. He was the president of Panama. And the president of Panama, he worked for the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency. Actually, Central Intelligence Agency put him in charge. And all they wanted to do was they wanted him to sign off the Panama Canal so that it has like a 1,000 lease agreement with America. And they wanted a military base in America. And they knew this is their man. And because he's their man, nothing is going to happen. They were also using Noriega America was also using Noriega to sell drugs, because the American government sells drugs. Drugs, cocaine, methamphetamine. Don't be surprised, it's not just the American government, the British government did too. It even fought a war trying to force China to buy opium. And you know, when China lost the war, China paid for the war, and it also was forced to give Hong Kong to Britain, so that Britain can develop it as a center of drug trade, that is cocaine. And some of the leading or the rich Scottish people were involved in the sale of these drugs. So that's what Noriega was doing. He was helping America sell drugs. He was also helping them run guns to counter rebels in South America and to topple government. But when, you know, he started acting confident, so they sent in the jackals, the hitmen, economic hitmen, trying to persuade him and bribe him. He refused. They wanted a canal, he refused. They wanted a military base, he refused. He started becoming confident and really being a leader of his people. And that's when they sent in what the Americans called the jackals. And they invaded, they bombed. Those are areas, they wanted that canal, can you see? You know, crossing the Pacific and the Atlantic. So they wanted it. When they began bombing of Nicaragua, no, not Nicaragua, of Panama, Panama City, they started in the section where a lot of poor people live, because that's where the military headquarters were. And the military headquarters had documents that showed who was really dealing with drugs and who was selling drugs, and so they wanted that evidence eliminated. And that's when they brought in American force, America and George Bush. And they were also testing the equipment. They were testing the military equipment to make sure that they were working properly. They wanted the canal. You know, so what they did, they went in, they killed a lot of people, a lot of poor people. They captured Noriega, took him to America in a cage, killed a lot of people, and a few installed a puppet government. And a few years after, Panama signed a very long lease agreement with America, giving America the Panama Canal, and you know, saying Panama was not secure. Panama also renounced the ability to have an army, so instead it would have a police. And since it didn't have an army, then America had to come in and protect the canal, and thus the establishment of the military base. How is that for democracy? Democracy number one, Panama. Democracy number one, Panama. Who removed the government of Panama? George Bush. American government. How did they remove it? By vote? No. By war and bloodshed. Who did they put in place? A Democrat? No. A puppet. What did they get in return? They got the Panama Canal, and then they got a military base. How is that? And they got to test their weapons. So soon after that, they'll be going to Iraq. They'll have experience. Let's go to another country. Let me give you another example. 1929, the culture we lost, the Secretary of State, at that time, America refuses to endorse a code-breaking operation, saying, gentlemen, do not read others' mail. That is when America was still a decent country. The President of America says, no, I am not going to read the codes of other countries because a gentleman should not read another gentleman's mail. 1941, that's when they created that office, Office of Coordination of Information. Coordination of Information, William Ware Beard Donovan headed the new intelligence service. I am going to tell you how the CIA was created and what it has done in the world. So we are in 1941. It's officially created after the Second World War, but they had that Office of Coordination of Information. That is at the height of the European War that was raging in Europe. Let's continue. 1942, OSOS created, Roosevelt Reconstruction. He got Office of Coordination and Information, something more suitable for covert action, the Office of Strategic Services. Strategic Services. So Donovan recruits so many of the nation's rich and powerful that eventually people joke that OSS stands for all, so social, all, so snobs. OSS. 1942. Let's play another clip. In 1943, Italy, Donovan recruits the Catholic Church in Rome to be the center of Anglo-American spy operation in fascist Italy. This would prove to be one of America's most enduring intelligence alliance in the Cold War. During the Cold War, the Catholic Church, because you know they are everywhere, they are priests, they are whatever, they acted as agents for the Central Intelligence Agency. In most parts of Africa, you know, they still act as agents for the Central Intelligence Agency. But at that time, they had a war. In 1945, Office OSS is abolished. The remaining American information agencies cease covert actions and return to harmless information gathering and analysis, because that was the end of the war. Now, 1947, Greece. President Truman requesting military aid to Greece to support right-wing forces fighting communist rebels. For the rest of the Cold War, Washington and the CIA will back notorious Greek leaders with deplorable human rights records. By that time, the CIA is established, and its first action is to support the right-wing government in Greece, to remove a socialist government because it was supporting the Soviet Union. Not because it was not supporting the people, no, but because it was supporting the Soviet Union. Play another clip. So, 1948, covert action wing created. The CIA recruits covert action wing, innocuously called the Office of Policy Coordination, led by Wall Street lawyer Frank Wisner. According to its secret charter, its responsibilities include propaganda, economic warfare, preventive direct action, including sabotage, anti-sabotage, demolitions, and evacuation procedures. Subversion against hostile states, including assassination, underground resistance groups, and support of indigenous anti-communist elements in threatened countries of the free world. So, you can see, when they create the CIA, one of its role becomes to sabotage governments, to remove governments, to work undercover, to evacuate, you know, to do anti-sabotage, demobilization, literally anything negative. So, in 1949, they start a radio station, the CIA called Radio Free Europe. CIA creates the first major propaganda outlet, Radio Free Europe. Over the next several decades, it broadcasts a blatant force that for a time it is considered illegal to publish transcripts of them in the US. This is the radio that the CIA created broadcasting in Europe, but what it was publishing, it becomes illegal in America because it was falsehood. Falsehood. It's the same as when you hear Voice of America. There's Voice of America's job is to spread falsehood, spread American propaganda, you know, spread propaganda that makes you hate your government, your country. It is part of the State Department. It's just blatant propaganda. That's what it is. Voice of America. So, in Europe, they had Radio Free Europe. It was so blatantly lying that, as you heard, for a time, it became illegal to publish anything they said in America, and yet America started it. So, let's go on. 1953, Iran. CIA overthrows the democratically elected Mohammad Mossadegh in a military coup after he threatened to nationalize British oil. The CIA replaces him with the director, the Shah of Iran, whose secret police, SAVAK, is as brutal as the Gestapo. 1953, when you think of 1953, Iran had a democratically elected president. He was called Mohammad Mossadegh. And he said, you know what, let's nationalize the oil. Because you know oil, every time you discover oil, the same jackals come. Total, Blackwater, all these companies, Shell and BP, Caltex, California and Texas. They come, they rob, they take. They give a small percentage. Already we haven't got oil, but you can see that Heritage has already got $3 billion. Not to mention that if we really needed to mine oil, we don't even have to spend millions of money on a refinery, no. We can get some more refineries. People are mining oil in Kuwait, Kurdistan. In Kurdistan, ISIS, they are mining oil in Syria. How do they mine it so quickly? Do they build a refinery? No, they hire trucks, they get trucks. There are trucks that you can put there and they refine oil and you start selling. But for us, they want us to build a huge refinery because the money will go elsewhere. By the time we get to start making actual money, the oil is finished. So this man Mossadegh, he wants to nationalize the oil so that the citizens can have part of it. But they overthrow him. The CIA overthrow him. They send one person, and that person has a lot of money. He buys off almost everyone. And gets the government overthrown. Mohammed Mossadegh. And then they put the Shah. And the Shah becomes the Shah. He becomes a real, real problem for the people, for the population. He becomes a real problem. Remember, if you want to send a message, type the message and send it 8008. So, let's go. Now we are talking about democracy, how they are being overthrown. Let's go to North Vietnam, 1954-1958. CIA officer Edward Lansdale spends 4 years trying to overthrow the communist government of North Vietnam using all the usual dirty tricks. CIA also attempts to legitimize a tyrannical puppet regime in South Vietnam headed by Ngo Dinh Diem. Those efforts fail to win the hearts and minds of the South Vietnamese because Diem's government is opposed to true democracy, land reforms, and poverty reduction measures. The CIA continues failure result in escalating American intervention, culminating in the Vietnam War. They tried today, secretly from 1954 to 1958, but it didn't work. Then what they do, they have their own boat, vessel, they bomb it and they bring the North Vietnamese under Ho Chi Minh. That incident is called the Gulf of Tonkin. The Gulf of Tonkin. It's called a false flag. The false flag incident is an incident where you stage something, you want something to happen, you stage an incident because you want to blame it on somebody else. So they create a false flag, and that's what happens. So, let us go on, let's see. Vietnam, Lansdale brings the Vietnam War, causes America eventually to invade because their efforts to remove this man had not been successful. Let's go to Guatemala now. Every time you hear America talking about a dictatorship, it is as though every time they have intervened on behalf of Democrats. No. American government normally removes democratically elected governments and installs puppet government. We had a situation in Guatemala in 1954 when the CIA overthrew the democratically elected government of Jacob Arbenzi in a military coup. Arbenzi was threatened to nationalize the Rockefeller-owned United Fruit Company, in which CIA director Alan Dulles also owns stocks. Arbenzi is replaced with a series of right-wing dictators who bloodthirsty the policies will kill over 100,000 Guatemalans in the next 40 years. So you can see a complete election. There is a democratically elected government in 1954 in Guatemala. It is headed by Jacob Arbenzi, and he is removed by the CIA, and a dictator is put in place. And these dictators will, in the following 40 years, murder more than 100,000 people. Can you believe that? You better believe it. And the story is just the beginning. Let's continue. We go to Hungary, 1956. Radio Free Europe incites Hungary to revolt by broadcasting Khrushchev's secret speech. You know, they claim that the president of Russia had a secret speech, and they broadcast it, in which he denounces Stalin. You know, he says that he doesn't like Stalin. It also hints that American aid will help the Hungarians fight. This aid fails to materialize as Hungarians launch a doomed armed revolt, which also invites a major Soviet invasion. The conflict kills 7,000 Soviets and 30,000 Hungarians. So, you hear that? Lies. They tell them, you know what, you guys, when you start revolting, we shall come. And they say, you'll come? Really, you'll come? They say, oh, yeah, we shall come, we shall be there. You know, you don't have to worry about us, we shall be there. Yeah, so, okay, we shall be there. Now, what happens? They start rioting, they are not there, they broadcast a speech, it was false. 30,000 people die, 7,000 Soviet troops die as well. Ah, but what happens? Yeah. Hungary was at peace, but they bring war and something happens. So, if you've just joined, it is you are with Kihura Nkuba on TV Africa, and I am on Will the Real Democrat Please Stand Up? We are looking at governments and how they overthrown, and the governments that have been overthrown, particularly by the Anglo-American Empire, what we call the CIA. They are having really, really trouble right now with a man called Donald Trump, a right-wing racist. But God, he can also, if you hear him speaking, you might think he's Kihura Nkuba. He's saying America has had enough. Americans are poor, they have not benefited from anything. America's 193rd poorest nation. God. Let's continue. Let's see another country. Look at the country. 1957, this is Laos. Up to 1973, the CIA carries out opportunistic one coup after another, trying to nullify Laos's democratic elections. The problem is that Pathelao, a leftist group with enough popular support to be a member of any coalition government. In the late 50s, the CIA even creates an army clandestine, a clandestine army of Asian nationalists to attack the Pathelao. After CIA army suffers numerous defeats, the US starts dropping more bombs in Laos than the USA dropped in World War II. A quarter of the Laotians will eventually become refugees, many living in caves. You know, the thing is, Most of the countries that America invades are really poor people. They are very poor people, all poor nations, innocent citizens. Those are the people they invade. They don't invade countries in Europe. They don't invade Russia. None of these, at the time the enemy was Soviet Union. They never invaded the Soviet Union. No. They invaded, imagine Laos. They dropped more bombs in Laos than they dropped in the whole of the Second World War. Can you imagine? Yeah? Can you really imagine? Drop more bombs than they dropped in the whole of Second World War. I hope you are listening to this. I hope you are listening. You know, you can go and find out, because sometimes when we talk about these things, this is not radicalism, this is not whatever. These are just facts. Countries that have been invaded by countries that call themselves Democrats. Listen and learn. They go to another country. Check and see. This is Haiti, 1959. America has invaded Haiti almost over six times. A small country. But why Haiti? Because Haiti in 1778, Haiti was producing 80% of France's GDP. It was the wealthiest nation on earth, Haiti. And in Haiti, that's where black people completely and thoroughly defeated the French white man. 150,000 soldiers commanded by Napoleon's brother Alaric. They defeated the Spanish white man and the British white man and changed and became the first nation where slaves overthrew the master and set up an independent nation. They changed the name from Saint-Domingue, which is the name that Britain, France had given them, and they took the African name of Haiti. What a country. And because of that example, there are countries that Europe, the Anglo-American Empire, will never allow to survive. Among them is Ethiopia. Ethiopia, you shall never be allowed to survive because you used to be the most powerful nation on earth. The most powerful nation. Ethiopia's tentacles covered the whole of Africa, covered the whole of Asia. They covered the whole of Japan. At one time, what we call the Indian Ocean was what? What we call the Atlantic Ocean was the Indian Ocean, was the Ethiopian Ocean. It was known as the Ethiopian Ocean. What we call West Africa was called Ethiopia Interior. So anyway, Haiti 1959, let's go to Haiti 1959, that's when America invades Haiti. Haiti is not even the size of Mbarara. It helps a military man called Papa Doc Duvalier become a dictator of Haiti. He creates his own private force known as the Tonton Macoute, who terrorized the police force, who terrorized the population with machetes. They will kill over 100,000 during Duvalier's family reign. The US does not protest their decimal human rights record because they had installed him. They had installed puppets. European nations want to deal with puppets. So don't ask me why leaders fail when they come to power. They begin to read that if you are not a puppet, you will be overthrown. So they decide to become puppets and allow the puppeteer to do most of the puppeting. That's what happens. Papa Doc is installed in 1959 in Haiti, one of the most glaring example, a country that produced some of the most wonderful brains Africa would ever put together. People like Toussaint Louverture, people like Dessalines, Pigeot, people like Boukman Ndouate, where slaves gathered all the slaves in a secret ceremony known as Baskau Men. And at Baskau Men, at this separate ceremony of Baskau Men, it was August 13th, 1781. August 13th, 1781. And that is when they sacrificed a black pig. And this woman called Fatma, sacrifice a black pig, sacrifice the blood of the pig, and all of them drink it and swear to avenge, to die other than live in chains. And that is when Bookman Duarte, dressed in flowing robes, he was a coach driver, which means he used to drive slaves to work for the white man, but all along organizing them, he escapes from Jamaica and comes to Haiti and mobilizes Haitians to fight for their liberty against the French. I love this brother. Bookman Duarte, he steps out in this yard, people cheering, singing, they are dancing, Fatima is there holding a youth, they are all having machetes and guns and whatever, and they swear. Now, before that, they had a man called Makanda. Makanda had been, was good at predicting weather, predicting where the French army would be coming from, where they would be landing. He was also very, very dangerous on producing poisons, poisons, to the extent that the one that they use in Western Africa and part of the Caribbean for poison, they call it the Tasman. Tasman is really named after this man. Now, what happened to Makanda is Makanda was arrested by the French. And what the French used to do whenever they arrest a black person, they'd create a very big fire, tie this black person with chains, put him in a fire and roast him in front of other Negroes, in front of other slaves. But you know what happened to Makanda? They put him in the fire, and Makanda kept rising and rising and rising, showed them the chains, bust the chains on the leg, jumped and leapt free. As the French soldiers who were holding guns shook and dropped the guns, and Makanda fled. Makanda in Haiti. Then after Makanda, sorry, I think that's maybe the spirit of Makanda coming to me. So after Makanda, you get Bookman Duarte on the ceremony known as Baskaume. That is when he steps in the ground and he says, the good Lord who created the sun that lights us from above, who stirs the clouds and makes the thunder roar. No, who stirs the seas and makes the thunder roar. That God, who is so good, is watching us. He knows what crime white people have done to us. The God of white people demands for them crimes. Our God demands good deeds. He will direct. No, but that God, that is why it becomes so beautiful. The first time I heard this, I said, no, that can't be true. I thought the teacher was making it up. He wasn't. He was this expert on Haiti from Chicago. He's probably called Professor Jacob Carabas. I had him repeat the words of Makanda, and I said, no. They couldn't be a slave at that time. 1781. I mean, that slave who didn't even read books is more of a philosopher than me. I can't put those words together. He said, the good Lord who created the sun that lights us from above, which stirs the seas and makes the thunder roar, that God is watching us. But he also said, but this God who is so good. No. He says, the God of white people demands from them crimes. Our God demands good deeds. He said, they have a God, okay, but it's not ours. We have a God and it's not theirs. Their God demands, the God of white people demands from them crimes. Demands from them crimes. Our God demands good deeds. Because black people are essentially good people. Black people are essentially wonderful people. Black people are essentially righteous people. There is nobody more just, more righteous than a black person. Although you are seeing us now at the bottom of the world here, when we are existing like grasshoppers at the level of dog eat dog, but this is not how we started. There was no war in Africa. It was a bad war if somebody lost his leg. Most of the wars were sham fights. Nobody ever went to jail. There was no word for jail in any African language. Nobody ever went to prison. So the God of black people demands from them good deeds. And your God demands crimes. So, okay, you know, if the God demands good deeds, Bookman, then what is it? Why are you calling us here in this forest? Why are we at this sacred ceremony of Baskal men? He says, but this God, who is so good, also demands vengeance. You don't know that about God. He says, this God, the God of white people says vengeance is mine. No. Bookman says, this God, who is so good, also demands vengeance. He will direct our hands. He will reward our efforts. He's telling them. Then he says, throw away the God of white people who has so ever oppressed us and speak to the African spirit within. Throw away the God of white people who so long oppressed us and speak to the African spirit within. Remember, he has already told them that the God of white people demands from them crimes. He demands IMF and World Bank, crimes. He demands invasion of all these countries, crimes. He demands slavery and African dehumanization, crimes. He demands the New York police and New Orleans police shooting black people like they are chickens, crimes. He demands getting black people and using them as alligator baits, crimes. He demands stealing cows from Kenya during the time of colonialism, 1915, 1916, 50,000 cows, 60,000 cows, 70,000 cows, and killing 1,000 people every day, the Taita, the Wahinda, the Maasai, you know, the Luo, you know, the Kalenjin, stealing their property and killing them because Imperial British East African Company had run broke. They took the cows. They took the goats. The God of white people demands from them crimes. Our God demands good deeds. But this God, who is so good, also demands vengeance. He will direct our hands. Bookman said the slaves. And they said, liberty. Liberty or death, rather to die on your feet and to live on your knees. Yeah? I already told you of a brother in Palmares, when we come to that, who was told he was going to podium to hang, and the priest followed him. He said, do you have anything to say? Then the brother turned and looked at this man bothering him. And he says, I came here to hang, not to make a speech. Came here to hang. Why are you bothering me? Didn't come to make a speech? This is a hanging, not some kind of of auditorium for a debate. But people are brave people. Powerful people. So what did the Haitians do? France threw Napoleon's army over the Pyrenees, because Napoleon was the emperor of France at the time. You've heard of the Emperor Napoleon had 20,000 men. There was a song. The Emperor Napoleon had 20,000 men. No, the Emperor Napoleon had 20,000 men. We sang with 21 in primary. And they all went marching along. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Yes! He had 20,000 and 40,000 and 100,000 and 150,000. Napoleon's army of the Pyrenees that defeated the army of the Mamluks in Egypt, that was undefeated in Europe apart from when they went to Russia. He sent that army against these African slaves. Imagine that. African slaves. Slaves have no military training. They don't know the fear of clouds. They have not read Sun Tzu. They don't know. You know, they never hired a man. They never killed a man. Can you believe it? So what do you think was going to happen? When the French, with bayonets and cannons, canon! Ouvre le canon! Huh? What do you think was going to happen? What the slaves didn't know was that, you know, they were all united under the African culture. They had sealed an agreement, liberty or death, to keep their affairs secret, to move and strike like lightning, to be with the spirit of an Egungun and appear everywhere. So Napoleon sends 150,000 troops, his army of the Pyrenees. It is commanded by his brother, General Malek. They arrive at the island. They start hanging black people. Hanging them. Killing them. Pushing black people. Burning. Scorched ash. But remember, Haiti is one of the most productive. It produces 89% of France's GDP. So Napoleon doesn't want Haiti destroyed, and he doesn't want the slave destroyed either, because who will produce? Over time, Bookman is killed after very many battles. The slaves reorganize. They capture the French. They learn to use their guns. They learn how to ride horses in a short time. A story is told. If you want to read this story, C.R. James wrote one of the most beautiful accounts, a book called The Black Jacobins. What a book! He tells this story of two African spies who had been captured, who allowed themselves to be captured, and they know they were going to be tortured. So, you know, they are sitting there quaking and shivering, and there is a big pot, a big saucepan, if you like, of boiling oil, because they are going to throw them in the boiling oil afterwards. So while they are shivering, they are asking them, and they are saying, how many guns have you got? And they said, we got guns from America. We have got over 70,000 guns. They say, 70,000 what? They say, yes. And then we have these long things, you know, like swords, pretending that they didn't have any military experience, like swords. And then there are also some small guns, like the one that this one is holding. They say, are you sure? They say, yes, let us show you. So they reach for the man just to demonstrate. But this brother gets the gun, revolves it around his finger, shoots this one. And the brother who was there shivering, looking really disheveled, looking like the most stupidest man you could get, draws the sword, chops off the heads of three officers, and the guy who had a big gun on the side The brother aimed one shot, still hit him in the head, fell down. And they jumped into the river and ahead of Grace and swam toward the other side. And when they got away, they started doing a traditional Kadodi dance, if you like. That is bravery. I'm talking about Haiti. That is why these countries cannot let Haiti survive. That's why America created this earthquake in Haiti and a program which is based in Alaska that creates tornadoes, that creates earthquakes. They can't let Haiti with people like that. Then they get too salivatory. This brother who could read, this brother who could write, this brother who could train, this brother who could coach, this brother who could strategize. He defeats 150,000 troops of the French, wipe them out. The French trick him. They call him, they say, let's sign an agreement. Let's sign an agreement. We stop fighting, you get independence. And at the time when black people were fighting, they were not even, at first they were not fighting for, they just wanted to be free. They didn't care whether they were ruled by anyone, they just wanted to be free. But they wanted to remain under France. And they started writing to Napoleon, and Napoleon, and Napoleon. And Napoleon started sending more soldiers and more soldiers. So when they defeated the army of La Lettre, Napoleon's brother, they invite, the commander invites Tusa to come and sign an agreement. Tusa's number two, a brother called Desiré, who looked so dark, darker than 150 million Midianites, says, don't go. Don't trust white people. Even good white people, you can't trust them, he said. He said, if the white man wants to sign an agreement, he comes here and he comes alone. Tusa says, no, no, no. Tusa, you know, was having an affair with some white woman, and, you know, and the white woman was encouraging him. So he goes, he sits in a boat with his chief of staff. They organize a dinner. They play very nice music. He's waiting for them to sign. The ship sails away. It starts moving. Tusa ends up in France. He's put in a castle in northern France, in extreme cold, denied food, and he's later killed by Napoleon Bonaparte in the north. But after they took Tusa, who made mistakes, a great person, Napoleon was probably the greatest general in Europe at the time. Hannibal the Black is the greatest military genius of all time. But Tusa Alvetur is really up there. But when Tusa is taken away, hey, they get destiny. And he made no mistake. He killed everything white that was in sight, that wasn't right. He killed a white cripple. If they killed one black person, Desiré killed 50. If they hanged one black person, Desiré chopped 50 white people and roasted them. It was not tit for tat. It was tit for tat. He burnt the entire cities. He burnt the maize, burnt the corn, slashed the sugarcane, destroyed the factories. General Desiré. They sent the Spanish white man, he defeated them. They sent the British white man, he defeated them. And he liberated Haiti. It was called Saint-Domingue. He even changed the name Saint-Domingue to call it Haiti, to reflect its African character. And he didn't stop there. He then prepared I come back. Because I was talking about Haiti, I didn't know I was going to go in this scale. But in the mountains, he built the largest military force underground and overground in the southern hemisphere up to today, bigger than the Pentagon. I'm telling you, these black people. And they did it without the French. And they established a set of rules, a charter, which charter even the French, during the French Revolution, were referring to. You're joking with these black people. They didn't stop there. They then said, since we are military generals, since we have liberated Haiti, since slaves are coming from Africa, since white people have taken over Africa, we are now going to sail and going to Africa and help our brothers in Africa liberate themselves. They are not going to stop there. No. They are going to burn the fire of liberty to take those drums of freedom to say forever and backward never. They got money. Gold. They gave it to a white man who had served with them to go in America and buy guns. When the white man got to America to buy guns, he used the money to establish one of the five universities in America. I think it's called the Carnegie Institute or something like that. The money from Desiree and Peugeot and the black slaves of Haiti was used to set up one of the first private universities in America. But they wanted guns so they can get cruise ships and sail towards Africa and take over the entire continent. These brothers from Haiti, you're joking with them, with their culture. Tutsela Vitu, Desiree, Makanda, Bokumandwate, the god of black people demands good deeds. Listen to this. When the Haitian Revolution, the story Napoleon tried to say, we cannot let this story be known anywhere. The Americans were teasing with Negroes in America. And they were saying, we couldn't let this story. The Spanish in Cuba, the British in Jamaica were saying, we cannot let this story. We must kill this story. But there was corresponding cosmic connection between Negroes and communication. And the story got to America. And in America, a black slave named Nat Turner organized over 100 Negroes. And they started slaughtering the slave master. The Haitian Revolution was the first revolution in history. First revolution in history where slaves overthrew their master and established an independent state. Never happened. It's never happened. And kept the state, by the way, which they are trying to destroy now with earthquakes and tornadoes and famine and everything. Haiti. When you go into Haiti, this is one of the islands where Christopher Columbus, first landed. Christopher Columbus, of course, was sailing with African sailors. And the boats that took Christopher Columbus belonged to black people. He sailed in three ships, the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. The Nina was named after the black brother, Pedro Alonso Nino. He owned the ship, not just captained it, he owned it. His brother captained the Santa Maria. And the fact that black people were involved meant that Spanish monarch, Isabel of Castile and Ferdinand of Aragon, could trust them. Because those black people that you see dancing around my shoulder were the black people who ruled Spain and Portugal from 1711 to 1501. Those are the people that you see in flowing robes. Even all the coat of arms of that period in Europe are that of black people. Pictures don't lie. No, they don't. So, these were black people who were thinking global. They were not saying, let us first liberate ourselves and liberate everyone. No. They said, all black people must be free, otherwise nobody is free. All black people must be free, otherwise nobody is free. They said, freedom ever, forward ever and backward never. They said, liberty or death. They said, give me liberty or give me death. They said, black people of Haiti, you have nothing to lose but your chains. I come and I live. I was born and I shall pass on. That is why I said to you, let him that is worthy be worthy still. Let him that is righteous be righteous still. That is because of that, because the God of white people demands from them crimes. That's why I say, let him that is wicked be wicked still. I'm sure you always wonder, why does he say, let him that is wicked be wicked still? If you have a God that demands crimes, you can't be righteous. So you can't be wicked still. Behold, I come quickly, my reward is with me, to give unto every man and every woman for and according to his reward should be. For in the beginning was a black woman. This woman gave rise to a human. Never was a time when black people are not, and never will be time when black people will cease to be. Because we are eternal, my brothers and sisters. Hotep, and I love you very much.